this? What is going on here?
I don't know what's going on with my hair. It's in its angsty teen phase at the moment of growing out from being cut off, and it's driving me mental. Hi, my name is Jasmine, and today I'm giving you a book review for The Once and Future Witches by Alex E. Harrow. As with all of my reviews, I will start off with a brief synopsis of the book before breaking it down into 5 categories, which is what I use to decide on my ratings for a book. So if you've read this book before, feel free to skip ahead to the actual review part. If you haven't read this book before, all of my reviews are spoiler free, so you should be able to watch this through to decide if you want to read the book or not without worrying about any spoilers. The Once and Future Witches is a historical fantasy book set in New Salem in the late 1800s, and it basically is a story that centers around the suffragette movement with witchcraft thrown in as well. The book also centers heavily around the concept of fairy tales and retellings of most fairy tales and folk tales, and it likes to pull those motifs from fairy tales and folk tales into a lot of the plot that happens with the story, but with a bit more of a modern twist and a bit more of a creative element to that storytelling as well. So it centers around 3 sisters: Beatrice, Belladonna, Agnes Amarantha, and James Juniper. All of these sisters have been estranged from each other since some point in their early childhood to sort of mid-teens, and they have all come to New Salem for their own reasons and as part of their own stories, and reconnect with each other through some twists of fate and magical events. And that's the premise for the start of the book, and the rest of the story follows their involvement in the suffragette movement and in trying to get some kind of rights for women in New Salem. And along with that, it also follows their rediscovery of witchcraft and the use of witchcraft in perpetuating the suffragette movement in New Salem. So that's a basic summary of what this book is about. Let's get into me actually talking about what I thought of the book. I'm gonna put it down now so that I can actually write some text and things on the screen, and also so that my arm doesn't fall off. So first up, let's talk about the setting. Like I said, this is set in the late 1800s in America. It's set in Salem, but in sort of like the concept of Salem, the first Salem was burnt down in a witch hunt, and then New Salem has been built on top of that or nearby that. So it's kind of like an alternative history in that it is set in America in historical events, but it's also reimagined those historical events to fit the fantasy world. And along with that, the concept of witchcraft also ties very heavily into the setting for this book, because a lot of the culture and the environment that they live in fuels what actually powers witchcraft in this world. So the concept is that witchcraft is embedded within nursery rhymes and folk tales and tales that mothers would tell to their daughters as they're telling them a bedtime story and things like that. By very nature of Alex E. Harrow's concept of witchcraft and how she decided to make the magic system work in her novel, the entire environment and setting also feels very steeped in history, and in particular in the history of women and mothers, and history that isn't particularly grand but is often just told by the fireside or by the bedside. Gives it a bit more of a homely feel, I guess, and a bit more of a maternal feel, which is really refreshing to read. It made it very comforting, I guess, to read. It made for a very gentle reading pace and a very gentle world to be living in those times that weren't filled with women's power and suffragette movements and battles and protests and march and things. So it kind of had this really twofold sense to the world, in that you have this concept of women coming together and community and story sharing and things like that, and then you also have politics and power and riots and marches and protests and things as well. It was definitely a bit of a mix going on in the book, but it all definitely worked together really well. And like I said, the novel itself feels historical, but definitely has like a fantasy slant to a lot of the events that are being told in the book. Like, it's set in the past, it's set in a world that we know and recognize, but it's also set in such a way that the events aren't quite aligned with what we remember the events being, in order to make room for that fantasy world to grow. Overall, I think I would have given the setting slash world building a 4.5 star rating. Like, it wasn't honestly the only thing that probably could have made me give this a 5 star rating, as if it had been fantasy London, which is my favorite setting to read about in any book ever. So 5 stars is reserved purely for that. But this book is right up there, very close second to that. Next up, I guess we will talk about the plot. The plot obviously follows 3 main characters, and it switches between perspectives of each of their stories and the ways in which they intertwine and the ways in which they also have their own stories to tell as well. And because of that, it definitely kind of had some ups and downs, I guess. There were times when I could put this down for a couple of weeks before coming back and picking it up again and not really feeling that urgency to pick up the book and to keep reading immediately. So it wasn't a particularly fast-paced book sometimes. Other times it definitely had some events that were quite thrilling to read about and quite fast-paced. So it definitely ebbed and flowed. I don't necessarily think that was in a bad way. Like, I don't think it ever really had a sense of lagging pace. It felt a lot more like real life in that, yes, there are some events that happen quickly and then there is a recoup, rebuilding period in between that as well. There are a lot of points of suspense during the book where I thought, this is it, we're reaching the climax, this is where things are going to come to a head and all of these different threads of stories that are being told are finally going to come together and you're going to see the big picture, basically. And every single one of those times I was wrong. And I think that's a sign of good story writing, to me at least, and that she was capable of having these multiple moments of build up and these multiple moments of, oh my gosh, is this what the story is about? Is this what's really happening? And I quite enjoyed that. I liked having those moments of, oh my God, I finally figured it out, and then being proven wrong and having a reason to keep reading to find out what was really going on underneath the surface of some of these stories. Yeah, so overall, it wasn't the most fast-paced of books. It definitely had some moments where I, like I said, could have just put it down, taken a rest, maybe even read another book in between and then come back to it, and that felt fine. I do feel a little bit disappointed in the wrapping up of everything and the big reveals that did happen, just in that I had, after all of those moments of build up and drop down throughout the book, I'd really built it up in my head. Like, I had so many conspiracy theories of what I thought was going to happen and what I thought was going to be the big reveal, that I think maybe, even though the final moments were really good, I think that just as a product of how much theorizing I'd been doing throughout all of the book up until that point, I basically set myself up for disappointment or for not really feeling like it was as good as some of my imaginings in the back of my head. So there is that as well, and because of that I probably would give the plot maybe a 4-star rating. Like, it was pretty good, obviously wasn't enough to keep me gripped all of the time, and it did have that moment of me being like, oh, is that what's going on? That's fine, I guess. Let's talk a little bit about some of these characters. So obviously the book centers mainly around the three sisters. One of my favorite things about this book is that no one of the three sisters ended up stealing the story away from any of the others. It's very easy for a story that has multiple main characters for it to feel like ultimately the story is more about one sister or one character than the other. To me, it felt like that balance was kept really even throughout the book. They all had some pretty big struggles. They had some pretty big character development moments and character realizations throughout the story as well. But they all had their time to shine, I guess. They all had their moment to show what they could bring to the story. And they all had their moments of influencing the major plotline that was happening in between everything as well. And I really appreciated that because I think it feels a bit more like the realistic nature of life, and that everyone feels like the main character of their own story, but no one is the main character of the story of a whole. As well as that, there was a very rich cast of side characters as well. We've got an entire suffragette movement of female characters as supplementary characters and secondary characters and things, and all of them also felt very rich, and a lot of them also had their own stories that were told throughout the main story as well. And there are a lot of women that I really resonated with and that I found myself really caring about and wanting to know what happened to them by the end of the book. And there are some love interests, and all of the love interests were also very, very human. They had their flaws, they had their good moments, they had their banter and their witty dialogue, and they were very well fleshed out. So that was also nice to see. And then, as I said in my summary, there were some bad people as well. And it is always a sign of a stellar book in my mind when the villains are real and when they have shades of grey to them and when they have human qualities and moments when you feel that moment of pity and connection with the villain as well. And these characters had that. The overarching villain of the book spends a lot of the story being this big bad, like darkness and shadows and evil powers and a sense of foreboding and general creepiness, like ultimate creepiness. And then as you get to know and spend more time with these characters over the course of the story, and you learn more about them and you see them through different characters' eyes. Are we done? I think we're done. I jinxed it. As you start to spend that time with the characters and you got to see them through different characters' perspectives, there gets to be a real sense of depth added to the villain's story, and there are moments of connection between the heroes and the villain, of them seeing kindred qualities in each other and realizing what that means for themselves. And you get to feel moments of pity and remorse on behalf of the villain as well. And that, like I said at the start of this section, is to me the sign of a really powerfully written book. That's what I want to see in a villain. I don't want some standard Disney villain where they're just doing evil because it's evil and that's what they were born to do. Like, the days of those stories are long past. We've evolved beyond that in our writing and in our storytelling and in the things that we expect from a book, and this book lived up to that new expectation of having good villains. So because of that, characters, 5 stars, straight out the gate. Good times with all the characters, just some excellent character writing, and something that really just took this book from being something that I really enjoyed to something that I utterly adored. Writing is another section that absolutely just lifted this book above my expectations and into something that I can already tell is going to be one of my top reads of the year. I underlined so much in this book, and if you follow me on Instagram, you'll have already seen some photos of like my underlining and my notes, but like I'll see if I can film a little snippet and show you, but there are just notes and love hearts and just gushing on my behalf of so many lines in this book. I thought it was stunning. It had some really lovely turns of phrase. It had some sentences that just made me go, yes, that's it. That's what I've been thinking and feeling in my heart for years. And finally, a book has put it on paper and I'm reading it here in front of me. Like, it was very, very wonderfully done. So once again, writing 5 stars. I thought it was really lovely, especially because I think that the writing is what really carried the book through those slow moments and stopped it from being a book that dragged and lagged and made it hard to read when you were in between the moments of climax. I do genuinely think that that is what helped carry the plot through some of those slower moments, is the just stellar, wonderful writing that was just a pleasure to read no matter what pace the rest of the book was. And finally, themes! Talking about themes, my favorite thing to talk about in any book. Obviously, one of the major themes is the concept of women in power. It draws a lot of parallel between the concept of a woman having a voice, being a woman who is also a witch or a woman having magic. So it's like meshing together of the concept of the suffragette movement and the witchcraft movement is done really well, and it makes witchcraft this really powerful allegory. I think that's how you say it, allegory, for the concept of women having power and being powerful. And I think that was done really well. I don't necessarily think that that's a new thing. Like, it's pretty well considered that the reason why witchcraft was so feared is that it does paint a picture of a woman having power, which is something that historically women weren't allowed to have. I can't remember what I was saying about witchcraft and power and stuff, so I'm just gonna move on to something else to talk about. One of the other main themes that I think was pretty prevalent throughout the course of the book, which might even be apparent from some of the stuff that I've talked about plot-wise and setting-wise, is the concept of what parts of history we value. And I think this is something that we already do talk about quite a bit, with the whole history being his story, and very much talked about the exploits of men and deeds and valor, and the actions that we value are the ones that are typically taken by men in Western history. And this book obviously sheds light on that topic, but on top of that, it does it in a nice, gentle way. I'm kind of tired of reading books that talk about these topics and just make it very bleak and very angry, and this book, instead of doing that, was just, it shed light on it a little bit. But overall, what it did was tell a story that was about women's history, and it told it through bedtime stories and children's rhymes and things that are typically unvalued when it comes to looking at history. And it kind of gave those things that are typically undervalued and overlooked, it gave them something powerful. It made them powerful. And I think that that was enough. Like, that was all it needed to do in order to send the message that it wanted to send, which is that there's more to history than just the big events and the actions of big men. There is also normal life. There's life and living, and there's women and community and things that happen at home and by the fireside and by the bedside. And those things are also important to look at when you're looking at history. And they're also just important in general. Something that made me walk away from this book feeling heartwarmed, if that's a word. It just felt good. It felt good to read something like that. And I think particularly I'm thinking about this because straight after reading this book, I read Ariadne, which is almost the polar opposite of that, in which everything ends badly and you just walk away from it feeling really bleak and downhearted. So it was nice to read a book that had feminist values, but did it gently and did it in a way that was actually positive and had happy endings and didn't leave you feeling like the world is a bleak place with a bleak future. So overall, 5 stars for the themes. So overall, I would have given this book a 5-star rating. The average for it turns into 4.7, which you could round down, but I do know that I adored this book, so I'm gonna round it up. So 5-star book, top read of the year already. It seems to be very underrated. It's sort of flying under the radar of BookTube and Bookstagram and the book community in general, but I think it was a really powerful read, and I think it was a very gentle, easy read as well, with some beautiful characters and some beautiful topics that it talked about. I just very strongly recommend it if you're interested in fairy tale retellings or like folklore style books, if you're interested in books about witches and witchcraft, not necessarily in like a Harry Potter fantasy-ish sense, but in like a traditional historical witch sense. This book is definitely all of those things. So it has that sense of old storytelling to it, and I thoroughly enjoyed it. I hope you enjoyed this review. I will see you for another video when I can, and until then, as always, stay classic.
The weather is frightening, the thunder and lightning seem to be having their way. But as far as I'm concerned, it's a lovely day.